I'm Nan Geschke, your host of the Los Altos History Show. Tonight, we are very fortunate to have as our guest Edgar McDowell. Welcome, Edgar. So pleased to have you here this evening.
Thank you for the invitation.
Well, you're very welcome. Edgar lived in Los Altos during the 1920s and 1930s. And although he lives now in Palo Alto, he's still very interested in our town and many of our inhabitants. One of Edgar's chief interests during his lifetime has been Boy Scouting. And we'll be talking with him tonight about his involvement in scouting. But first, Edgar, I think our viewers would really like to know more about you and your family, how your family came to this area. I understand that your father first came out to attend Stanford. Is that correct?
Yes. He came here from Ashland, Ohio, to attend Stanford in 1895. When the university was 4 years old.
Wow.
He was the first member of his family to attend a college. Stanford had no tuition at the time, but you still had to have money for room and board. My father needed to earn a little money on the side, so he was looking for work right away and succeeded in getting a part-time clerical job in the registrar's office at Stanford. And at the same time, he secured an assignment with the Southern Pacific Railroad as their representative on the Stanford campus to keep them informed about movement of students and names of new students and where they were coming from, and faculty the same, and also because this university that had been so highly publicized in the Eastern papers as a university built out in the middle of nowhere, why, when visiting dignitaries came out from the East by train, the Southern Pacific liked to have somebody show them around Stanford. So my father.
So that was your father.
My father had that assignment.
Well, that was quite a nice assignment. And he held that job for many years.
He held the Southern Pacific assignment for 42 years.
42 years.
And when he graduated from Stanford, it took him 5 years because he was working a little on the side, graduated in 1900. He was offered a job as assistant registrar at the university, and the Southern Pacific offered him a full-time job as in their passenger sales department. He elected to take the Stanford job, but he kept the Southern Pacific job on the side. So he was worked at Stanford for 37 years and for the Southern Pacific for 42 years.
Oh, so he actually
held. Till he retired at the end of 1937.
Oh, wow. So he actually held two jobs then.
Well, the main job was with the university. The Southern Pacific job was just a little side issue.
A side issue.
But it brought a little income.
Oh, sure, and that was.
And a pass on the railroad.
And that was important, wasn't it?
It did, not only for him, but for his family. So I rode the railroad for free.
Well, did you take many family trips then?
Yes.
On the railroad?
He took me east on a business trip for the university and 1914, when I was 6 years old. I can still remember it.
Oh, isn't that interesting? Mm-hmm. Now, I understand that he became acquainted with Paul Shoup, who was is considered our town founder here in Los Altos. And Paul became the president of the Southern Pacific at a later point in his career, but I believe that you and your father yes. Became acquainted with one another. Is that correct?
Correct. Paul Shoup became president of the Southern Pacific in 1929. He went to work for the railroad in 1892, I believe, in San Bernardino. Mm-hmm. And he received his first official appointment in 1900 as district freight and passenger agent in San Jose. And that was the position to which my father reported in connection with his work for the Southern Pacific at Stanford. So he came under Paul Shoup's jurisdiction, and they became very good friends and remained so as long as they were both alive.
And I believe Paul Shoup actually encouraged your father to help him sell lots when he started to sell lots.
When the Southern Pacific built a track from what's now South Palo Alto to Los Gatos, going right through what's now the middle of Los Altos, Paul Shoup, I think, had something to do with the railroad acquiring the land to get through here, and the land in the what would be the downtown Los Altos was owned by two sisters,
Sarah Winchester.
Had the only house really in Los Altos, and they weren't keen about having the railroad come through the middle of it.
No, there's stories about them.
So I think Paul Shoup worked a little bit behind the scenes to help bring that about, and then he organized the Los Altos Land Company, which bought the property that the Winchesters owned. It bounded roughly by Edith Avenue, San Antonio to El Monte, and then the creek back to Edith Avenue.
We call that the downtown triangle
yes.
now.
Uh-huh. And he subdivided the Los Altos Land Company, subdivided that property, and Paul Shoup asked my father to help sell lots, which he did. And
he was quite successful too, wasn't he?
Well, I don't know how many he sold, but the commission that he got came not in cash, but in lots. So he wound up owning several lots in Los Altos, and including two on Main Street between 1st and 2nd Street, about where Mac's Tea Room is now. And those lots stayed empty because that first block in Los Altos did not get completely built up in the 30 years before my father died in 1938. And he'd paid taxes on those lots all those years.
And they never were developed.
Never were developed.
Isn't that interesting?
And, there was no buildings on Main Street beyond 2nd Street except for the McCrum House, which was between 3rd and 4th. Otherwise, was very little in the way of business houses in Los Altos.
Right. Now, what about your mother, Edgar? I know she did.
My mother came to Stanford from Iowa, Davenport, Iowa, in 1902. She was the third in her family to come to Stanford from Iowa. My grandfather was principal of a school in Davenport, and he believed in education and saw that all his children got a college education. And my mother met my father at Stanford. Strangely enough, I think the earthquake was what finally got them married. The earthquake was in April of 1906, and the damage at Stanford was so great that the university closed, and Dr. Jordan, the president of the university, sent the students home, told the seniors they'd get their diploma by mail, and so my mother went back to Iowa. After about 2 months, my father couldn't stand it any longer, and he got on the train, went back to Iowa, and talked my mother into marrying him right away. And so they were married in Davenport.
And they lived on the campus at
Stanford? honeymoon, came back to Stanford, and soon after built a house on San Juan Hill, the first house completed on that hill for faculty, and moved into it when I was 4 months old. And one of the odd things about that is that move forward a few years, Herbert Hoover had become chairman of the Commission for the Relief of the Belgian People in Europe there after World War I broke out. The Hoovers had been living in London, where he was involved in mining engineering, had become probably the top mining engineer in the world. He undertook this food assignment for the Belgian people and never again worked for pay that he kept. And he had another 50 years to his life from then. But after a short time, he decided Mrs. Hoover and the boys had better come back to the United States. He wasn't spending much time in London anyhow, and there was war risk there in London. They came back and settled in a house across the street from us at Stanford. So I became very well acquainted with Mrs. Hoover and the two boys. Alan, the younger, was my age, and we did everything together for a few years there. When World War I was over, the Hoovers then undertook to build their own house in the lot next to us at Stanford. So we had adjoining lots, and they built the house that is now the home of the president of the Stanford University. Going back, my father had become acquainted with Mrs. Hoover when she was still Lou Henry, because they were students at Stanford at the same time. Herbert Hoover had already graduated, but just a few months before my father arrived, so that he didn't get acquainted with Mr. Hoover until later. But he and Mrs. Hoover remained good friends, after she came back from London to live on the campus.
And I understand that they wanted your home, and that's one of the reasons why you moved.
We moved to Los Altos because of the Hoovers. Mrs. Hoover's parents lived in Monterey, were by then quite elderly. Her mother, Mrs. Henry, was not well. She wanted to have her parents living close to her, and she asked my father if he would consider selling our house, because we were the nearest house. And this was done rather quickly. We didn't even have a house to move to, but my father said he had all these lots in Los Alamos, why not build on them?
Sure.
And so he hired Burge Clark to build a house for us. Burge was just getting started as an architect in Palo Alto. I think we were the 37th house that he designed out of many hundreds over the years to come. And while the house was being built, my mother and my two younger brothers, who were at grammar school, went to Pacific Grove to live. My mother liked the Monterey Peninsula. She came from Iowa, about as far from an ocean as you could get. And when she saw the Monterey Peninsula and Pacific Ocean, well, she fell in love with it. But they didn't want me to move because I was already attending Palo Alto High School.
And then you went on.
I came and lived with my grandparents. My grandfather retired after 40 years of being principal of the same school in Davenport, Iowa, and since the three of his children who had come to Stanford had stayed there, why, he and his wife, my grandmother, and their youngest child came to California to live, and they bought a house in Los Altos Avenue, moved in there in 1913. It was one of three houses on Los Altos Avenue at that time.
Is that right?
Now, it's still there.
Before we get on to you and your scouting, I wanted to just ask you, I knew your mother was active in the in the mother's group at Stanford and also the garden club in Los Altos, is that correct?
Oh yes, after we came to Los Altos, my mother first was busy raising her children. As soon as she felt she had them far enough along, she could start getting into activities. She became active in the PTA here in Los Altos, and she became president of the garden club, which held a show once a year down in what I think is now Shoup Park.
And then
she became the third president of the Stanford Mothers Club, which was organized in the 30s. And incidentally, the first president of that club was Mrs. Paul Shoup.
And that's interesting.
Then my mother also became president of the AAUW, that's American Association of University Women chapter in Palo Alto, shortly after it was established in the 1930s. So she became quite active.
Very active. Now we want to talk about you now, and that's, I know that you became interested in scouting, or at least your father became interested in scouting for you. So how did you get attracted to scouting in the first place,
well,
Edgar?
My father sent me to my first scout meeting. I don't think I knew that the Boy Scouts existed.
And the
scoutmaster was a Stanford law student named Edward Harper. He was had been during World War II, World War I, had been a commissioned officer in the Army in Europe. And I don't know this for a fact, but I suspect that my father had recommended him to be the scoutmaster of this troop. In any event, he had me join, and I guess I was hooked, because I stayed active in Boy Scout work for the next 31 years.
31 years, and I understand you were scoutmaster at one point.
I was scoutmaster altogether for 7 years, spread out a little bit. I was scoutmaster on three different occasions. The first time, I wasn't old enough yet to be a scoutmaster, but let me back up there. After Mr. Harper, Victor Morgan, the minister of the Episcopal Church in Los Altos, was scoutmaster for a year. Mm-hmm. And when he moved away, he recommended me as scoutmaster. By then I was a student at Stanford, but not yet 21, which you had to be officially a scoutmaster. So my father was registered as scoutmaster, but he never came to a meeting. And I served for a year, then I stayed out a year, then I was scoutmaster for two more years. Then I was, Southern Pacific moved me out of town for a while. I don't know whether I mentioned yet that I worked 42 years for the Southern Pacific.
So you followed your father's in your father's footsteps
full
then.
Time. Uh-huh. And when I came back to Los Altos, then I picked up and was scoutmaster again for another 4 years. So altogether, I served 7 years as scoutmaster.
Now, where did the scouts meet?
When I joined in 1920, we were meeting in the second floor of the building at Second and Main Street.
The bank is there
now. The northwest corner. You know which building that would be.
And it's a two-story building.
It was the only meeting place there was in town, really. Everything, their school had been there even to begin with, and I guess maybe some church meetings. Mm-hmm. And problem having it for Boy Scout meeting was that there was a grocery store underneath. And if we ran around too much,
you got in trouble.
It knocked the ceiling down, or the plaster down into the groceries. So Captain Harper, we called him, but he took us out and marched us up and down the main street of Los Altos to give
get
us
some
a little
of that
exercise.
Out, and huh?
there weren't enough automobiles in those days, but once you could do that.
And then there was a hall that was built.
Then a scout hall was built and completed in 1922. I should back up just a little bit here on the Boy Scouts. They were founded, I believe, in 1907 in England by Lord Baden-Powell. And there was a businessman from the United States. He was in London on a foggy day in 1908 and having trouble where he wanted to get to. Uh-huh. And a boy came up and asked if he could be of help. And the offer was accepted, and he guided this man to where he wanted to go. The man then tried to tip him, and the boy told him he was a Boy Scout. They didn't take tips for doing a good turn. Mm-hmm. The man was intrigued, and he asked more about it, and then found out more about it before he returned to the United States. When he did, he got some of his business friends in New York together, and they organized the Boy Scouts of America.
Isn't that a wonderful story?
So the troop in Los Altos then was started in 1917, only 9 years after the Scouts had come to the United States. Herman Peters, a real estate dealer in Los Altos, was the first Scoutmaster.
And you were what, the third Scoutmaster?
I probably was the third.
Third. Now, what were some of the what was some of the outings that you used to do?
Well,
you said you went.
Mr. Harper believed in getting us outdoors,
yes.
And I remember we took a hike to Felt Lake, back of Stanford University, one mm-hmm. Saturday. Other places we took hikes on Saturday, and then he liked to take us out to El Monte Road to. And Moody Road to the what's now the Dubinek place,
which
then called Hidden Villa.
Yes.
And there we went a little bit south, I suppose it would have been, up a creek to a place called Ewing's Cabin. And we would camp there from Friday evening until sometime Sunday. And there weren't many automobiles then. We walked. We carried our mm-hmm. pack, our bedding. We didn't have sleeping bags then either. I don't know whether they'd been invented or not, but we sure didn't have them.
The ground was hard.
And we took blankets and a ground cover and some food and spent the weekend out there. I don't know how many times we did
that. Do you remember any of those boys that may still be living here in Los Altos? Are there any of those scouts still around?
Well, thinking of the time when I was scoutmaster, going back to the beginning, the only boy I know of that's still alive of that very early group was Carl Shoup. He's still living, Paul Shoup's older son, still living in New Hampshire. I believe he's 97 years old.
Oh, my.
And I have been in correspondence with him.
Uh-huh.
That the boys that were in the troop when I first was scoutmaster, Alan Cranston is one that's still living here. And probably the most distinguished of all the scouts that I had. It was, he joined in 1926. And it was quite a thrill when I could sit in the Senate gallery back in Washington.
And watch one of your scouts.
And look down on the floor and see one of my scouts there representing California in the Senate, which he did for 24 years.
Yeah, that must have been very exciting.
Other boys that, still live in Los Altos that I know of from my time as scoutmaster would be Jim Ramsey, whose father had a garage on First Street, Bob Keller, whose father had a service
yes.
station on First Street.
Bob was one of our guests here.
All right. Mm-hmm. Kent Wilder, George Cummings, one of the old timers.
Yes,
he probably
one of our
goes
neighbors.
Back to my first stint as scoutmaster and is still living here in Los Altos. There's three other boys I'd like to mention. Mention first, the highest rank in scouting is Eagle Scout.
Yes.
At least in those days, about one scout in 100 ever reached that rank. I think the percentage is now nearer 2%.
Uh-huh.
But Captain Harper, Victor Morgan, never so much as mentioned the word Eagle Scout to us. I never had heard of them. At that time, the whole emphasis was on now simply getting to the rank of first-class scout. But somewhere along the line, while I was scoutmaster, we discovered that there was such a thing as an Eagle Scout. And finally, In 1937, 20 years after the troop started, while I was still scoutmaster, we had our first Eagle Scout. His name was Gilbert Gamblin, and he was followed very closely by two more, Warren Jensen and Pat Taylor. The three of them had the badges awarded to them the same time one night in 1937 down in San Jose.
That is so, that's a wonderful story. I can't believe it, Edgar, but we're almost out of time, and there's still a lot of questions I haven't been able to ask you about your life and your work on the Southern Pacific, but maybe we'll do that another time. But we've really enjoyed you talking a little bit about your family, about your father and your mother who came here to attend Stanford, and the relationship you've had with the Hoovers, and then your wonderful career as a scoutmaster in Los Altos, and that troop, I guess, is was the first in Santa Clara County. So I want to thank you so much for joining us tonight, and thank our viewers too for watching the Los Altos History Show. We'll see you the next time. Thanks.
All right.
Yeah.